except that I will give a very brief introduction of each of them. So we have first with us Vivek Prabhakar. Vivek? Vivek is running a company, Chumbak.com, and he is actually offering something which is innovative, and I would leave it to him in terms of what is his offering and what is the business proposition he has. We have Jaideep. Jaideep, can you stand up? Yeah. Jaideep is in fast foods, and he is cashing on this whole trend of fast food and offering some innovative offerings which are Indian in taste. And are you offering it outside today? Do you have a stall here? Do you have a stall here outside?
No.
Okay. So I'm sure many of you have tasted his wraps. And then we have Subrat, whom I've known for many, many years. He has ventured out of a corporate life into an entrepreneur role, which is, I would like to congratulate. I think it's a big step. And he is truly offering something which is innovative, which can actually make our lives easier when you have some difficulties. And finally, we have Bala. Who has actually encashed on the need to have one-stop service for durables. And he's tied up with some chains. And I'm sure his cutting edge is the service he's providing to the households. So with all that, I would welcome you to this discussion. And we will start off with Vivek. And give you about 5-7 minutes, and then, yeah. Then are you ready with us, or you also need a clicker? All of you have a presentation? Oh, okay. Excuse me, the organizers, we need a clicker. It was lying here. Why did you take it away? You can do it. So maybe can I invite Bala to, yeah. Thank you.
Good afternoon to all of you. And I'm Bala Subramania from Jeeves. Jeeves is basically a third-party service provider for consumer durables. I'll just briefly explain to you how we got this idea. Myself and my co-founder, Alok, we used to work in BPL. And though we were not from the service background, we were witnesses to the trials and the tribulations that BPL went through in setting up its own service department, trying to service the customer. Initially, the company wanted to have its own in-house department of service, and as the numbers grew, as the volumes grew, if you all remember, BPL was the market leader in consumer electronics between 90 and 2000. The number of people in the service department also grew, and at one point of time, the management felt it was probably not their core business to handle service internally, because it was becoming unviable and unmanageable. So they tried to outsource the service to the franchisees. And believe me, we had a nightmarish situation. We could not find a single service provider for one city. Even in a city like Mumbai, Delhi, we had to appoint about 15 to 20 franchisees across the city. We had fluctuating levels of service. We had problems in uniformity in reporting and things like that. So with this kind of a background, Alok and I thought there was definitely a need for a pan-India service provider who could be a sort of one-stop shop for all the service requirements. With this aim in mind, we started Jeeves in 2007 August. Made a very humble beginning. One small office in Bangalore, 8 employees, one single client, and 30-odd franchisees across the country. And today, in the last 5 years, we have grown. We have close to 400 employees on our hand, on our company rolls. We have our own offices in 24 cities in India, and we are also operating with our associates, the franchisees, in about 225 cities in India. What are the major challenges that we faced in setting up this company? The first and the foremost was the technicians, the manpower. It is basically a very manpower-intensive industry. So the technician was a little skeptical to come on board into an unknown company. And during our interactions with the technicians, we figured out one thing. Most of the technicians were working for proprietorial concerns, like the franchisees, who did not offer them any social welfare benefits. And when we started talking to them about the ESI benefits, the Provident Fund benefits, and the pride of working for a private limited company where he could sport the company uniform and then the identity badge and things like that, we were able to successfully sell the idea to the technicians, and we did not have a problem in recruiting them. In fact, in the last four years, though the attrition rate is there, we have been able to manage the situation pretty well. Similarly, the franchisees had a mindset. They had a major problem. They just wanted to deal with one or two brands. They did not want to go and expand. So we sold them the idea that if they were to tie up with Jeeves, they would not have to go and sign up with the service departments of various companies. Under one single umbrella, the Jeeves could provide a host of brands to them, and they could provide service to many companies, not just one company. So thanks to this, we were able to tie up with franchisees. We have close to 225 franchisees with us. The third and the most important thing is the training. Companies are coming out with newer products, newer features, variants, new models, and the technicians need to be trained on all these products regularly. We cannot have the prospect of a technician walking into the house of a customer and telling him, I have not seen this product before. That can do irreparable damage to the brand as well as to Jeeves. And believe me, training the technicians across the country is not an easy task. It is not that I just trained a couple of guys in Mumbai, Bangalore, but the training has to get disseminated down the line right up to places like Rajanandgaon, Dinajpur, Kharagpur, you name it. We are present in all those places. It's a Herculean task, but we have been able to do it through a combination of technology and, of course, the manual process. Manual process, we still need to depend because... Okay. Okay. I probably skipped this PowerPoint. So today the consumer electronics industry is estimated at about 34,000 crores. There's a huge opportunity for a pan-India service provider like us. Now I already explained the background. This is where we stand today. And coming to the challenges that we faced, the major part, the first two were, of course, the manpower and the franchises. The third, I was talking about the training. And the fourth one is when we are in the business of servicing, we need to ensure that we have the availability of spare parts and components at every location in the shortest possible time. This was, again, a major challenge. So we set up our own warehouses. We created a hub in Bangalore, Mumbai, and Delhi, where we identified reliable vendors who could supply us spares at the shortest possible time. We did not want to block up too much money in the inventory. So we've been able to work on this, and we are able to supply the spares and components to any part of the country within a short period of 48 to 72 hours, and this extends right up to Assam and the Northeast. Of course, the host of services that we provide is the in-warranty and out-of-warranty services, installation, commissioning, the entire range of products, consumer electronics from a pop-up toaster to a plasma TV, the washing machine, the air conditioners, the entire consumer durable products, you name it, we are servicing them. Of course, if you were to ask me what is mean by learning from this is, as I explained to you, it's basically a manpower-driven industry. We need to harp on the point that the productivity has to be good. The productivity of the technician is not good. We are in trouble. We need to keep them motivated. We need to keep them trained so that they are abreast with all the latest gadgets, the features, and the developments. And of course, as I told you, we need to ensure we have a proper supply chain management in place to be able to service the customer in the shortest possible time with genuine spare parts. Some of our leading clients today, we are virtually with all the modern retail. We service their private labels, some leading MNCs like Toshiba, Panasonic, the entire list. And then, of course, the other Indian brands like Micromax, Tata Sky, HCL, and leading insurance like Tata AIG and Allianz Global Assistance. Our future plan, we have done business to business, B2B, for about close to 5 years. So we realized there is a huge potential in going direct to the customer. There are about 175 million households in India with more than 400 million products. And this year, we have taken our first baby steps in launching our direct-to-customer product, the annual maintenance contracts. We are now offering annual maintenance contracts to all the cities in India. We have just made a soft launch in Bangalore. We are now rolling it out in all the other metros this month. So we will be servicing all brands, all products. Suppose, just for instance, a customer were to have a Samsung refrigerator, LG washing machine, and a Godrej air conditioner. He would have to probably, once the products go out of warranty, he has to contact the respective service providers or go to the local mechanic who may not be well-versed in these products. Jeeves provides you all this. The customer needs to just ring up Jeeves, and we are just one call away from all the customers. And we are able to service the entire range of products, all brands, and at the shortest possible time. Well, gentlemen, ladies and gentlemen, that's it from me. I just want to tell you that anytime any of you have a problem with any of your gadgets, just think Jeeves. We are just a phone call away from you. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Bala. We will now go to Vivek. Okay.
Just waiting for the presentation. Yeah, hi. My name is Vivek. I'm a co-founder of a company called Chumbak. We're a product design company which kind of focuses on the travel, souvenirs, and apparel market. We're about a two and a half, three-year-old startup. And so today I'm just going to talk about who we are, what we do, and also some of the stuff that we've learned along the way. So, thank you. So just quickly, a lot of people ask me, where did you get this name Chumbak from? Chumbak actually has a very interesting etymology to the word. So Chumbak actually is Chumma plus Buck. And, so all of us know what Chumma means. And Buck actually means stones. So kissing stones is what is magnetic, so magnets. And that's another kissing stone, but we're not going to talk about him today. Stuff that we do a lot of stuff. We do apparel, accessories, we do home and lifestyle products, we do travel and souvenirs, stationery. I'm just going to talk about just two products that, one of my two favorite products that we do. One is, we started off actually with our entire theme has always been India. So we talk about, there are things that only us Indians do very uniquely. And actually one of them is not poking fun of yourself, so we decided to do that. We started off with this poster called You Know You're Indian Because, and listed out all the very many things that only Indians do. For example, Indians have very bad handwriting. Indians buy 10 kgs of rice when you can buy 1 kg. We all have very funny nicknames. So like Sita, Geeta, Sweetie, Pinky, which has got nothing to do with what our actual names are. So this product is one of my favorite products. The other thing is Ravana. Ravana, actually, if you read about Ravana, he's quite well liked. He was a good king. He was all of that. Very bad choice in women, but overall a good guy. So when we did this Ravana fridge magnet, it was a really, really huge success. And for us, we said, what do we do that we take the Ravana fridge magnet and move it across product categories? And we had the problem of, say, for example, how do we put it on a t-shirt? It'll look white here, and all of that. So what we did was actually create the world's first vertical Ravana. So those are the kind of products that we do. We do fun Indian stuff. Our startup story, I'm just going to quickly share some of our learnings that we've had. And one of the first things that, I mean, we keep telling people is to get your hands dirty. You can't be CEO from day one. You can't have a corner glass office from day one as an entrepreneur. It reminds me of this poster that you can pick up. And so you pick it up and it's got this huge, you know, it's completely covered with carbon ink. And suddenly when you realize it, when you're opening it up, your entire hands are covered with carbon ink. And it's a blank piece of paper. But for you to actually see what's written on that blank piece of paper, you have to rub your hands around it. And then it reads, the future belongs to the few of us who are still willing to get our hands dirty. And this is what our learning has been. Just get your hands dirty, get into the business, and then that's the only way you'll learn. At Chumbak, of course, we look at it slightly more differently, but it's the same kind of picture. The second thing is focused passion is better than just pure energy, which is passion. All of us are passionate about stuff, but focusing on something and doing that really well is something that we've learned. To illustrate, I can give you an example. You take the typical game of table tennis that you're playing. If you look at the time spent, 10% is playing table tennis, but 90% is spent chasing the little ball around the room. So getting your priorities right is really, really important. The next piece of learning we had is team. I mean, now speaking about your team, building teams is one of the greatest, I mean, all of us here, we've been talking about it, is the greatest challenge for any startup, building a team. So, and it's a foundation, I mean, of the company. So if you look at the kind of people that you're hiring, always hire people, one, who are smarter than you. I mean, you're going to get, if you get people who are, you know, you're smarter than, you're going to have a, you know, whole level of C, D kind of class of this thing, saying that they're not as intelligent, you're not learning anything from them. If you look at that, again, you know, pie chart, I love these pie charts. 10% is liking the same things, but 90% is hating the same stuff. It is about the money. You know, a lot of entrepreneurs start up and saying that, you know, I'm going to start a little bit and I'm going to go, and the first day itself, I'm going to meet these VCs and angel investors and all of that and get the money. It's very important to actually put in your own money from day one. Unless you're invested in your own idea and you have self-belief in that own idea, it's not going to work out. At 2 o'clock in the morning, that's the time when you're going to be sitting and, where do I get the next business from? Where do I get the next order from, or something like that? Be social. Today, all companies, I mean, everybody's on Facebook, Twitter, Pinterest, and all those other companies, but really be social. Don't just get onto Facebook because it's as a tick mark in your marketing plan. Today's environment is very different from what it was even 2-3 years ago, not 10-15. Talking to customers is not a one-way dialogue. It is a conversation. We live in this age where people believe, I mean, youngsters believe this, that, you know, life is too short to remove the USB safely. At Chumbak, we're pretty, you know, social in that sense, that conversations are very, very important to us. Our DNA of our brand is conversations. Talking to people, listening to them, trying to figure out what's happening, and then getting feedback for your products and that. That's very, very important in any entrepreneurial business that you start. Say no to perfection. Perfection, actually, in my mind, is a myth. It doesn't exist. We live by this, you know, thing that stops saying I wish and starts saying I will. Every day at Chumbak, we wake up and say, good today is better than perfect tomorrow. That's what we live by. don't keep waiting to get that perfect business plan going. Don't keep waiting to get the perfect color of your logo going. Start the business. All these things come along a little later. Lastly, again, risk. Risk is a lovely word. I mean, very few people have jobs and start companies. There is no way that you're going to continue working in one job and go back home at 7 o'clock, 8 o'clock at night to start working at the other company. Take risks. Typically, if you look at an instruction manual for anything that's difficult, anything that's risky, you typically look at the cycle. You struggle, then you give up, then you justify having given up, saying, you know, actually the environment was wrong, there was a downturn. And then you continue repeating step three until you're convinced, saying that you keep on justifying, saying that, yeah, it wasn't my fault. Yeah, so, and I'd like to end with a little video that we have, since it's Christmas next week. Sorry. Can we play the video, please? Sound. Sorry, we're having some technical difficulties. This reminds me of good old days of Doordarshan, where they rukhavat ke liye khed hai. Doesn't matter, it was without sound, that's no problem. Anyway, yeah, that's it, that's our startup story, and thank you so much.
Right, Vivek.
Thank you. Sorry guys, just before we came on to the stage, there was a mass exodus of people I noticed. Now, some of them have trickled back into the fray. So hopefully there's at least quorum for me to say something. So anybody knows about our company called Fasos? It sells wraps on the street. Can I have a show of hands? Wow. So I don't have to explain, you know, what we do, I guess. For the folks who don't know, we are a small chain of restaurants which sell desi wraps. Now, when I was summoned here, people said that I had to make slides. Now, you know, I was a consultant, so I used to make loads of slides every day, and each of them used to change the world one way or the other. But I have not been doing that for the last 2 years while pretending to be the CEO of Fasos. So please forgive me for my bad slides. Now, Kallol and I, we started this company, our first store in 2003. And like most important decisions in our lives, it was decided over a bottle of Old Monk and, you know, bitching about how job sucks. Now, you know, both of us are Bengalis, right? So, I mean, that's proof enough that, you know, in five generations in our families, nobody has done anything to do with business or profit, per se. It was all about poetry and economics and that sort of thing. But then, and I didn't start selling a newspaper route when I was five, so I didn't have that sort of inclination either. But then we were like bored of burgers and pizzas and all these other crap that you get. And we were traveling the world at that time. So we thought, let's have our own place where we can just land up and have something that we like if the maid didn't turn up. So that's how we started Fasos. And then, you know, a lot of people ask us, what is the meaning of that name, Fasos? You know, we were pretty drunk when we came up with this name. It's actually an acronym. And I would request you to not to disclose it to the outside world. It's not public consumption. So the acronym is, it's fanatic activism against substandard Occidental shit. So that's really Fasos. So we sell desi wraps. So, you know, we started this in 2003, and then we moved on to other useless stuff like MBA, marriage, becoming father. So that one was important. But then, you know, the business was going on. We got to about 6 outlets till 2010. It was quite profitable at that time. So we thought, like true opportunistic Bengalis, like, okay, let us come back and now take the business because it's already profitable and get it to the next level. So 2010, we got back to this. And, you know, in the last 2 years, we put 40 more outlets in Bombay and Pune. We hired a team that is, I don't know whether capable or not, but it's the world's best team to go for a drink with. And then also, yeah, we managed to convince Sequoia that it's a good business. And lastly, we got the company back into red. So yeah, we are not profitable anymore, but hopefully someday. So that's basically the chronology of Fasos. Now, I'm also supposed to say something useful, so... okay. So, basically, you know we make wraps, but we also break a lot of norms, really. And I'm not saying that all those breaking norms has helped us, like, because we screw up, like everyone else. Maybe a little more than everyone else, but... you know, I'm not going to talk about the making wraps bit. I mean, it's for you to comment on. I personally have it for lunch, snacks, dinner, and that's my single most important contribution to the top line of the company. And yes, to my middle line as well. So I'm going to talk about the breaking norms bit, if you are with me, because we have really broken a few norms here. So the first one is... hiring for entrepreneurship and not experience. Now, when we came back to take over the company and started building it, we hired, you know, a 15-year KFC veteran, Kentucky Fried Chicken veteran, who has worked across the world, etc. The first day at office, he asked me, "Boss, can you give me your manual, training manual?" I said, "Boss, we don't have one. You have to make one." That was the first conversation. Then we had a couple of others whose most organized bit of work was their expense claims, where I found stuff like, you know, bistleri water, pan masala, and stuff like that. So we got rid of all those folks, you know, very quickly. And then we said, okay, we'll hire for entrepreneurship. People who are self-starters can deal with ambiguity, uncertainty, and we'll fill the company with such people. So we released an ad in imjobs.com, where we asked MBAs with like, or engineers with 2-3 years of experience of writing PowerPoint slides or selling soaps in the market, sorry, sir, and all of these things, and asked them to come to Fasos and build a company, pick a few stores, manage the P&L, get the company to the next level. We got about 1,500 responses from across the world, from all the business schools in India, good business schools in India, as well as a few from US as well. And we hired about 5 of those people. And these are the people who are really responsible for whatever growth we have seen in the last 1.5 years. And you know, one of these guys who was with HUL, Hindustan Liver, the only thing he did about HR was bitching about HR, you know, before coming to Fasos. And he came to Fasos and took over our HR and training department. No experience whatsoever. Today, I'm proud to say that we have one of the most innovative training model in the business, which is our next topic, which is my next breaking norm theme, which is we started a university called University of Rapology, or UNRAP, basically unwrap your potential. So we hire from NGOs, we hire from some underprivileged background people, and we train them, indoctrinate them Fasos way of doing things, and then unleash them onto our stores. The third thing that we have done is there is no customer service department in Fasos. I don't know how many of you had problems with Fasos wraps, late delivery, etc., etc. I guess at least 90% of you will have had this experience. But then you would have always got a response within 10 minutes, either from me or someone who is managing the city or managing an area. So at Fasos, we don't have a customer service department. It's us who take the customer calls, and we get back within 10 minutes to the 10-minute rule, which cannot be broken at Fasos. The last one is zero selling. So you will not have us say that our wraps are delicious and this and that. Everybody says that. So, like the 10-minute rule, we have another rule in our communication, which is, will someone do this this particular way? If the answer is yes, we are not going to do it. So for example, we run a secret code campaign. So which is like, on particular day, we release a secret code on social media. and people have to say that code to get a 20% discount on a free wrap. On Valentine's Day, if any other company would do it, they would say, I love you, or Rose, or some shit like that. But on Valentine's Day, our secret code was, I hate you. And then on Rajnikant's birthday, our secret code was, Yenna Raskala. Now, nothing, this is like fantastic, right? This is the first time in the history of mankind you were abusing someone and getting a reward for it. So, which is like the customers are absolutely thrilled about it. But anyway, so we have kept that mode of communication all the way. So I would say these are the four things, four norms that we have broken. We've broken many more, some of which cannot be disclosed in public forum. But, you know, these are the big ones. I have a short video. If the video is working, that's fine. Otherwise, I think people have had enough of me. There is a video. Thank you very much.
You wait for half a minute if the video works. Otherwise, you go to the next speaker. No, I don't think it's likely to work. Okay, can we hear Subrat?
Good afternoon, friends. I think we're really running behind schedule and...
We have a dream.
I think you can go ahead.
Wait, it's not showing here at least.
We have a dream. Deeply rooted within the Indian dream, a philosophy started by two philosophers to build a philoclastic brand, where one day there would be the freedom to express delivery. That's philo, the philoist, where we would turn philosophers into philoists, neoists into philoists. Start a new movement of our socialism. Be different. Just shoot. Be part of the association. Are you, that's the wrong slide.
Fantastic.
Okay, great. That's a good idea.
Yeah, I think we really have went through some consumption stuff, which is also, you know, making us drool about food now. It's going to be lunchtime. And we spoke about assistance which runs our kitchen. I'll request for the presentation while I start the conversation. Now we will talk about something which is really part of our everyday life. I'm Subrat, and my friend and co-founder Gagan, both of us have started this company called One Assist, and we'll learn more about this now. You know, we were clear that we are getting into an assistant space, but if you look at today's life, you know, it's so much happening, and everybody, all of us are chasing, we are running. It's faster, higher, stronger. How do I do well? How do I earn more money? How my company does better? There's so much of business around that, and that's really the new life mantra. So much to do and so little time, and we are all busy running around. But still, I think there's a classical theory that I must be in control about all aspects of my life. So we are running a large toolkit. You know, if you can look at it, there's so many stuff that we are managing every day to cope with our day-to-day life. And that precisely was the insight for us that, hey, it's getting clumsy, we are cash rich, time poor, and there's so much important stuff to manage. And hence, what is the role that One Assist can play in customers' life? And when we spoke to consumers, they said, I wish I can delegate. And that's where we learned help is a very much acceptable norm, and it's no more a four-letter word. And that's Indian psyche asking for help itself is a kind of a behavior which is not there. And that's where the opportunity for One Assist comes in. So what we did and what really helped us was, I think the core first building block was to understand what exactly are the consumer anxieties that we can address to? Like Harsh was talking about, when the need is latent, you really have to identify what is that need gap, because there's nothing like this which is existing in the marketplace. So the first thing we did is we went to customers and we asked about, what are your day-to-day anxieties? From the time you wake up in the morning, and right now when you're sitting here, and while you're just stepping out and you're trying to check your mobile, until the time you retire, you go back to bed, what are the thoughts that's crossing your mind? And hey, that was really a lot of stuff. And what are the pain areas, you know, whole day? I mean, we are not showing that gesture, but your mind is thinking like this. There is the first thing you wake up and you have to go to the town side for a meeting, you're thinking about the traffic. How do I beat the traffic? Will I be able to reach there on time? And then it's about your career. How do I get my next promotion? How do I meet my next quarter's numbers? How do I my business grow quarter on quarter? And there is health, family, happiness, health, family, medical emergency. So interestingly, these are the anxieties which have really popped up. If you look at it, there are six of them which came up. Every day, every life moment, sometime or the other, we are thinking about these aspects. Like it says, my child is an uncut diamond. That's true. That's all our priorities. So I really want the best for my child. And of course, wealth. I mean, I need to earn more to accumulate my savings and to take care of my lifestyle. So the key insight we got in this entire is that, you know, if I have more, I also need to protect all that I own. So there's a lot of stuff that we own, important stuff which you own, and we don't possibly are managing how to protect them, and they're unprotected. So that was a key insight on which we worked on, that what are your daily belongings or essentials which can cause a lot of pain if they go missing. So the key insight again is, so we are coping with everyday tasks and needs with everyday essentials. For example, today morning when you left home, what did you check? What did you check? What was your checklist? What all you checked for? What is it that you will not leave home without? Mobile, wallets, cards, keys, right? So we don't realize subconsciously. In fact, watching in this conference room and just before that, in the last 1 hour, I've seen people reaching out to the mobile 6 times, 8 times. So the point I'm trying to say is that today it's part of our modern day reality. It's an extension of our body. It's like extended limbs. If you look at your smartphone and your wallet, and we keep doing this, checking that, you know, every time you are getting down from a cab or getting into something, you're checking, have you left behind something? This entire anxiety is there and it's hidden. And imagine if these two things, these two dear friends, go missing. What happens? How will you feel if your mobile goes missing? What will you do if your wallet goes missing? You just stepped out of a cab to catch at the Mumbai airport to take the flight, and you're already running left, and you left behind your wallet. You checked in, you sat in the flight, and then you realized, oh gosh, my wallet is missing. And imagine those 2 hours, 2.5 hours of excruciating anxieties and harrowing experience. And any of these are literal disruptions, and it really brings things to a grinding halt. And that's the role one assist is playing in your life. So what are the options left for you? Obviously, you pray God. Yeah, you can keep calm, which is difficult, and you can call your mom or maybe mom-in-law. That doesn't help. And you're definitely panicking. You can press the panic button. And at that point of time, you wish, there is somebody I can reach out to. There is somebody I can talk to. And that's where One Assist comes in. So 8080333333, if you're our customers, from panic, we take care of everything that needs to be done in that particular moment. And that's the role of One Assist in customers' life. So basically, we are a round-the-clock assistance and protection company for all your valuable essentials, like your smartphone, your wallet, your travel documents, your other personal documents. This was the key consumer insight on which we have developed our products. And if you look at the product proposition, so what we do for our customers, so the three things that we do for our customers, one, we safeguard your personal belongings, which is more of your digital identity, your identity, your data, your documents, right, your smartphone, your bank cards, your PAN card, your driving license, all that is building your identity, and you're running your day-to-day life. Second proposition is that we assist you 24/7, wherever you are in the world, if any of these things go missing. We quickly come into action and do all that stuff that you had to really worry for and take care of. For example, on one call from anywhere in the world, we will block all your cards. We'll block your SIM card with the operator. We'll protect you against any kind of credit card fraud on the lost cards. Not only that, we also arrange for your replacement for your PAN card and driving license. If your wallet goes missing, you're likely to miss these two important documents. And the third aspect is that we are not only helping you to get quickly back into business as usual or a life of back to a normal life without disruption, we are also helping you, we are protecting you against any kind of misuse of those valuables. Today, if your mobile phone is lost, there's a lot of data. Your mobile banking, your passwords, a lot of stuff, your social media, everything that you're using on our smartphone is open. It's already, the application is open. Anybody can access your photos, videos, your applications. And the risk that we don't realize is very high. So what OneAssist does is that we essentially protect you against any misuse. Similarly, when your wallet goes missing, we not only block your cards, we also give you a fraud reporting, pre-reporting fraud cover up to 7 days. Sometimes you lose our plastics and you realize it later. So it's all about not only a one-stop shop for assistance, but also preventive, any kind of misuse of your important stuff. And that's the story. We have just gone live in July this year. We are seeing a lot of traction. The fundamental belief is that we are into the business of helping people. It's an help, it's an assistance, which all of us need. And these are really our today's reality in terms of your wallet, mobile, passport, travel documents. Without that, life can really come to a standstill. Thank you.
Thank you, Subrat. We heard four fascinating stories, and we have limited time for some question answers. So if there are questions, please raise your hands. Yeah. Why don't you just speak out here?
My question is to Vivek.
Yeah.
Your company is mostly design driven. So how do you protect your design? I mean,
copywriting, trademarking.
Does that help?
It isn't legally enforceable, but now what happens is we heard a story while ago. Today, if I give you the secret recipe to Coca-Cola, which is locked up in vaults in Atlanta, are you going to take the same thing, build another Coca-Cola and compete against Coca-Cola worldwide? I don't think so. Our look is very unmistakably Chumbak. So someone goes and copies it and stuff like that, that's one thing. Second thing is that we're constantly innovating. So today, if I have a cricket T-shirt, tomorrow morning I have another one. So you're, you know, copying last year's season stuff and stuff like that.
Yeah. Thank you.
Any more questions? Yeah, please. From there. The question is, what keeps you up at night running this business?
Most nights I'm up in any case, so it doesn't take much to keep me awake. I think it's the people. How do I get, like today we have like 700 people on the ground, and attrition, training them, you know, sort of getting them motivated, come to work every morning and do hard work, etc. That's the big ask. That's the biggest sort of challenge to scale up.
How does OneAssist prevent misuse of the media that you have lost in it? It's a little...
You're talking about the smartphone data?
Yeah.
Yeah. It's basically when you become a member, we get a link and you download the application. So what it does is that it's taking a backup of all your personal data real time. And the good thing is that, see, our key insight while building the product proposition was that we are not a DIY society. It's not do it yourself. You know, many people sitting here might feel, yeah, this application is available on iStore, this is available on Android Market, this is available there, that was there. The key insight we have worked on is that how can it become one stop? So how it works is that it's anyway taking your data, and your data is backed up and it's safeguarded with us. When you call OneAssist saying that, hey, I lost my phone, on that call, we are triggering 4 or 5 services. We are blocking your SIM card, you're remotely locking your phone, there's a remote data wipe which is happening. And not only that, we are also arranging for a courtesy handset for your doorstep delivery within 6 hours with your contacts restored. So the whole insight has been that we are an assistance company, we are not an application company. The key insight, the inertia that all of us have that prevented us from doing anything like that is what we are trying to bridge in.
I have a question. This is a characteristic of our country, and I mean, be it as somebody as big as Marico or somebody who's into t-shirts or somebody who's into fast business like yours, Jaideep, we have low penetration of almost everything in India. At the same time, we are characterized by high competition, cutthroat competition, right from the MNCs at the top and the unorganized guys at the bottom. And we are somewhere in between. So how do you see, I mean, this is a question open to all, in fact. How do you see it as how will we overcome this challenge and actually think that, okay, we might aspire to be a global brand rather than somewhere just lying in this, you know, this middle quadrant where I'm talking about, you know? How do you see that Indian businesses are really going to aspire to become a global brand and actually take over the world, or just keep fighting in this middle orbit?
I mean, I have a take on this. I mean, it could be right or wrong. I would ask you a question back. Would you buy a television from Dell? No? Yes?
I mean...
Would you buy a television from Apple?
Yes.
Yes. Both of them are consumer electronics companies. Both of them make computers, you know, MP3 players, etc. But you are ready to buy anything from Apple, but not so much from other companies. So which means that there is a bigger why that is there, more than products, more than you know, what you sell, more than your service. You have to connect to a bigger why. You know, why do you go to Apple and not someone else? So I think that is the only way you can fight the MNCs, because I have about 1/1000th of the money that they have, like a McDonald's or a Domino's, etc. I mean, it's my specific example. I cannot fight them dollar by dollar. I cannot fight with advertising. I cannot fight with putting more stores, etc. The only way I can fight, and we are far from achieving something there, but the only way we can fight is by hooking that big why, you know, by getting to the head of the people through a bigger purpose than the product. I think that's the only way to sort of transcend the sort of...
I'd like to respond to that. I think, see, this entire concept of zero-sum game as an industry or as a category is diminishing, because new categories have been getting created every single day, or an adjacent category. Even Harsh was talking about that. So I think the key point is that how well do you understand your consumer and what exactly you are trying to do. That focus that we were talking about in the panel was discussing, all that is very relevant. So once you have an identity and you have an expertise and you're playing to your strength, once you know that, yes, for example, if ASOS know that we are the best in this business, that's where the entire world can be your marketplace. And then, of course, you have to understand what are the cultural trends, what are the consumer behavioral trends, and the market trends. Similarly, for an assistance company like us, which why not? It could be in any of the developing markets, because these are relevant need sets. I think it's all about getting the insight right, having a strong, very strong value proposition, and establishing your identity through that.
Sir, would you like to come in?
We have to give others a chance to answer the question, because this can go on for 1 hour. This question is a 1 hour debate, actually, if you ask me. But I think we have limited time and would like to give some others a chance to ask.
Hi, my name is Manish Vora. It's for OneAssist, actually. You are saying that you have all my personal data, all my everything. How that saved my data is with you, because somebody backhand has all the details of all my things. Like, so how do you secure that?
I'll ask you a couple of questions. Like, if I do a Google search on your name now, I'll be able to find out many more details about you. The reality today is that there's a lot of stuff which is already available. Where you have checked in, where you have gone for shopping yesterday, where do you possibly stay, what are your coordinates, where are you working. The point what I'm trying to highlight is that there's many places where we are unknowingly, we are sharing our personal information and document. As a company, what is our promise is that your data is safe with us. And hence, what kind of technology standards, what are the security standards we are complying to, and at what level we are managing your data is very critical. So that has been the key focus. So we are already with the three-month-old company. We are already ISO 27001 certified. We are in the process of getting into the PCI DSS compliant. That process is already on. So yes, what you're saying is that the trust and credibility in our line of business is very critical. And hence, am I collecting or sharing only the desired data, and how well am I doing with your data in terms of protection is critical. So we are really taking care of...
Because nobody has my PAN card number, nobody has my credit card number, nobody has that thing. That is very critical actually. Rather than that, one call is fine, but if somebody has my credit card number, somebody knows my in and out, that should be quite a secure system, and that can't be possible by machine, I suppose. It's human are behind that, who is looking at that data and talking to me.
Sure. Yeah. I'll also request you to check our website and get to know more why thanks. Your data is safe with us.
Okay, thank you very much. I think we'll have to close the session. There is a lot of pressure on time, so I'm sorry for those who have not had a chance to ask any questions. The four entrepreneurs are going to be here, so you can use the opportunity to ask questions to them. But let me end by wishing all of them all the very best. Each of you are embarking on a new journey and a very interesting journey. Very innovative journey. I, for one, will definitely want to work with each of you, at least try and taste your facials, wraps, and maybe work with each of you. And I'm sure each of the person in the audience will try and give an opportunity to work with you and spread the word around that this is a great business you run. And there is, I think you need traction from this group here, who's present here in terms of your own business. So with that, all the best to you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah.